Matric 2020 revision with crazy physics. Our singular aim is to make your matric exam easy. Hello, good afternoon, everybody. This is Bishop again from Crazy Physics. This afternoon, or this morning rather, we want to have a marathon race on our chemistry exam. We would run through a full question paper like we did for maths paper 2 on a Saturday and run from now till 2 p.m. And we hope it's going to serve you well. So get yourself something to eat, get yourself some water to drink, get yourself some energy drink if you do need that. All right. We would run through the whole of chemistry. We will try to go into details when we get to every particular question. So please, it's going to be well-detailed, well-informed classes so that we are then armed to write our exam. All right, please do not forget, would love to read from you, your name, your school, the province where you're watching from. Please kindly give us a feedback. You are the one only, probably, you know, that you've not sent a feedback. Others have been sending their feedbacks. Please just send us an email, info@crazyphysics.org.za. We would love to read from you, all right, on how these episodes have been assisting you and what you would like to see, you know, coming forward. If you want to get this clip, please go to our YouTube. Make sure you subscribe. You will have this video also streaming on our YouTube, and you can actually download for your use and watch again. You have another day to watch the whole thing again in case you miss something and you could not rewind that particular spot. You have an opportunity. Get onto YouTube and download. How do you download? You go to YouTube and search for Crazy Edu TV, or you search for Crazy Physics. We would be right there with you, and you'll have this whole presentation again on your phone. You can also request the PDF on 0817442103. If you are in one of our groups, we will just send the PDFs to you. All right, without saying much thing, let's go ahead. The first question here says, which one of the following is a secondary alcohol? All right. Oh, I had that secondary alcohol on the line. What is a secondary alcohol? Let's quickly define, because we want to go into details. All right, I'm going to write primary this way, secondary that way, and tertiary that way, just to make things fast. All right, so a secondary alcohol. All right, it is an alcohol where the carbon atom that has, or that is attached to the hydroxyl group. Remember, it's an alcohol, so we talk about the hydroxyl group, OH, okay, is also attached to two carbon atoms, or I could actually say two alkyl groups. If you don't remember the alkyl groups, you're fine. You can just write two carbon atoms. What will my structure look like? So in general, this is what I will then draw. Now, this carbon here is known as a secondary one. It is the one that is attached to the OH group, and that same carbon is attached to carbon 1 and carbon 2 there. All right, so you have two carbon atoms. Not necessarily the numbering, I'm just counting. All right, so we have two carbon atoms. That makes it a secondary alcohol. If I then do this, take this out and put a hydrogen here. Now, you see, the carbon atom that has the hydroxyl ion group, rather, is attached to just one. Then that becomes a primary one. If I want it to be a tertiary, what am I going to have? I'll have that. And I'll have this as another carbon. So how many carbon atoms am I dealing with? One, two, and the third one. All right, so our focus is on this carbon that has the OH group. and how many carbon atoms it's attached to. All right, so in this case, I'll have it as what? A tertiary. So what's my correct answer here? Ethanol, guys, you need to know your nomenclature. Let me show you something very quickly. We call this the organic nomenclature. Crazy Physics organic nomenclature. This is beautiful. We play with time. It is meth o'clock. It is earth o'clock. It is prop o'clock. Butte pens, you know, just play with it. All right, so if I say earth, you see earth there. Ether is 2. Ethanol, but that is a primary alcohol. Ethanol, 2. All right, so my correct answer here would be C, butane, 2, all. Let me draw butane, 2, all for us quickly. Bute is 4, so I need 1, 2, 3, 4. Carbon 1, carbon 2, carbon 3, and carbon 4. The OH, 2, all. All right, it's there. So I have my hydrogen, and all the other hydrogen atoms. All right, now let's go check our carbon. The carbon atom that has the OH group, all right, is connected to how many carbon atoms? 2. That makes it a secondary alcohol. So the first option is C, 1.2. Which one of the following will rapidly decolorize bromine water? This is how to differentiate between a saturated compound and an unsaturated compound. Let's get a fresh page to deal with that. A saturated hydrocarbon and an unsaturated what? Hydrocarbon. Now, a saturated hydrocarbon will go through what you call a substitution reaction, while an unsaturated will go through what? Addition reaction with halogens. So what we then do is we pass, all right, this gas through bromine water. If you pass, either we use bromine water or we use bromine gas, all right, which is brown in color. So if a saturated compound reacts with this bromine water or bromine gas, depending on the setup, a color change would show that it is unsaturated. All right, so an unsaturated compound will decolorize bromine water because it is going to undergo an addition what? Reaction. Here with a saturated, there is no color change. It remains as brown. All right, so chlorine water is brown, okay? It will then be decolorized by an unsaturated compound. And by an unsaturated compound, we refer to your alkenes and your alkynes. So let's go answer that question quickly. Which one is the correct answer? And I hope you remember the general formula. Let me just quickly write that. CnH2n minus 2. Those are the two that will decolorize bromine water. So let's see. It says, which of the following would rapidly decolorize bromine water? We need to look for an unsaturated hydrocarbon. Guys, if we say hydrocarbon, what does it mean? It means an organic compound that contains only carbon and hydrogen atoms. Automatically, this is wrong and that is wrong. Those are not hydrocarbons. All right. Now, what about this one? 1, 2, 3. We've got C3H, 3 plus 2 plus 3, 6, 8. This is an alkane. Actually, this is propane. This is saturated. It will not decolorize bromine water. We need an alkene or an alkyne. All right, I've got a 3 carbon here, C3H, 3 hydrogens, 1, 3 plus 1, 4, plus 2, 6. oh, this is an alkene, if you remember the general formula, and this is propane. All right, so my correct option is A. Okay, I hope we're beginning to remember all the concepts and you're learning. All right, so learn that unsaturated hydrocarbons will decolorize bromine water. 1.3. A functional isomer of ethyl propanoate. Let's go again and get a fresh page. Functional isomers, quickly. Functional isomers. I'm just going to give you a quick cheat here. All right, this is what we say. For every function, this is just a quick way, there is a cake. Good. For every function, there is a cake. What do I mean by the word cake? They say the AK in the middle. Aldehydes and ketones. Aldehydes and ketones are functional isomers. The two in the middle. While this one here, carboxylic acid and esters. Carboxylic acid and what? Esters are also a set of functional isomers. So aldehyde and ketones, these are just the two that you have according to our scope of study. Aldehyde and ketones, AK, and the CE would give us carboxylic acid and esters. Those are functional what? Isomers. For every function, there is a cake. Now let's go check. A functional isomer of ethyl propanoate. Ethyl propanoate. This is an ester. So what am I looking for? I am looking for a carboxylic acid, COOH, with how many carbon atoms? That's the thing. Ethyl, F, do you remember our organic clock? F is 2. Okay, and your prop is what? 3. Let's go check again. So I need ethyl 2, prop 3. 2 plus 3 will then give me 5. What do I need? I need a carboxylic acid with 5 carbon atoms, and I'm done. A carboxylic acid with 5. Remember, esters and carboxylic acids are functional isomers. Oh, by the way, your carboxylic acid must have a double oxygen. Let's cancel out option. Option A says C4H9CHO. Wrong, 1 carbon atom. Option B, C5H11OH, 1 oxygen atom rather. Wrong. Let's check the next one. C4H9COOH. Oh, that might be my option. But before I check, let's check D. CH3CH2CHO, 1 oxygen atom. Let's confirm that now. We have C4H9COOH. Could that be it? Yes. C4, I'm going to write it here. H9. Oh, yes. How many carbon atoms do I have? 4 plus 1. 5 carbon atoms. And it's a carboxylic acid. My correct option is C. Beautiful. You knowing your content gives you an edge. Question 1.4. Consider the balanced equation for a chemical reaction. All right, so we have this 2NO, that is nitrogen monoxide plus oxygen, to give us 2NO2. The activation energy of the forward and the reverse reactions are 156 and 175. I need a graph to quickly show you this. All right, so we have a reaction that says nitrogen monoxide plus oxygen will then give us nitrogen dioxide. We are told that the activation energy for the forward reaction, activation energy, let me write it nicely. Activation energy for the forward reaction is 165 kilojoules, all right, and EA for the reverse is 170. Let's just get that figure. All right, 156 and 175. 156 and 175. Lovely. Good. What are we looking for? We are looking for the heat of reaction. For this reaction is, so we're looking for the heat of reaction. Let's go check how to deal with this. We're looking for the heat of reaction, delta H. Now, the first thing we need to establish here is that, is this going to be an exo or endothermic? And how do we establish that? Just going to show you a trick quickly. So we have our reactant. Let's draw a profile. Good. We have our reactant. Remember what activation energy is. It is the minimum energy required to start a reaction. So we always draw our activation energy from the reactant. So I'm going to have that as my reactant. Now we are told that it is 156. Okay, activation energy. Look, let's do this. We're going to get somewhere here. We're not sure of what's going to happen here. But here it is 156. Now, for the reverse reaction, it is 175. Hold on. By the way, I cannot go beyond this, whether it is forward or reverse. So if this height is 156, if I then need to measure 175, it means I need to go a bit further down. I don't know if it makes sense. If from here to here is 156, and this is my activated complex, that's where I'm going to stop. So my activation energy is actually here. And that is 156. Now, if I want 175, starting from the top, it has to be longer. Oh, so if it has to be longer, then I would be dealing with something there, which means that my product is actually here. So that when I talk about the reverse reaction, we're going back this way, this becomes my reactant and this becomes my product. This is 175. So automatically this means this reaction is an exothermic. Somebody said, how do I get confused? Let me show you a quick way. This is what I do. I draw both, if you want to quickly get it. You are standing here and you are standing here. All right. Now, where is it easy for you to get out? It's easy for you to go out from here than here. Easy here. Easy. From here. Exo. So it is easy to exit. So this is my exothermic graph and that is my endo. And we know that our exo, delta H, would be what? Negative. For endo, our enthalpy would be what? Positive. All right. So I am looking for the heat of reaction here, which is going to be negative. And this is where my heat of reaction is represented. The difference between H product and H reactant. So delta H, let's write here. H product minus H reactant. But we have established that this has to be an exothermic because the activation energy of the reverse is more than activation energy of the forward. So I can then say 156 minus that, and that will give us negative 19 joules. All right, 56. Let me just confirm quickly. 156. Just did that in my head. Minus 175. Negative 19. Beautiful. So it is exothermic, kilojoules per mole. Okay, let's pick our answer. Where's my question page? Do we have negative 19? Yes, our answer is A. I hope it makes sense, the approach. I hope the approach makes quality sense to you. So you need to draw. Let me go back again and show you the diagram. All right, so it's 156 for the forward. Please understand, you draw from the reactant. That's where you start from. So it is the reactant to the activated complex that gives you activation, what? Energy. And I'm not going to go beyond that. All right. So if I want 175, it has to start from there and go down because it's longer. And that gives me exo. By the way, this thing is burning in oxygen. Anytime you see plus O2, it means it is burning. And if it is burning, it is an exo thermic reaction. I hope we are okay. All right, our first set of questions done there. I'm just going to move my page, and we have the next question. All right, the given reaction below reaches equilibrium in a closed container. So we're talking about chemical equilibrium now, right? The Kc value is 0.4. I'm going to quickly extract my information. Kc value is 0.04. All right, at a certain temperature. Oh, and we are told that this is what? Exothermic, delta H. Again, we are burning this in oxygen. 2SO2 plus that reversible to give us sulfur trioxide. Delta H is less than zero because it is burning. Which one of the following factors will change the Kc value? This is very straightforward. Which one of the following factors will change the Kc value to 0.4? Hold on. There are two things that have been asked here. Kc old is 0.04. Kc new, guys, this is so good. This content is so good. First thing, the only factor that changes Kc, the only factor that affects Kc is temperature. Okay, now if the only factor that affects Kc is temperature, automatically you know what that means. My first option says increase in pressure, out of the game. Option B, decrease in pressure, out of the game. The third and fourth options now says increase in temperature and decrease in temperature. But let's see something here. All right, what happened to our Kc? Kc value actually increases. Oh, all right, we're going to explain all of this right now. Kc value increases. Now, we know that Kc is the ratio of the concentration of the product to that of the concentration of the reactant. Okay? If I want my Kc value to increase, it means my reaction must favor the forward reaction to form more products. So if I want Kc value to increase, I must favor the product concentration, which is the forward. So it means my forward reaction must be favored. And this reaction here is what? An exothermic. What favors an exothermic? I'm going to write that in green for you. And this is exo, right? Exothermic. A decrease in temperature. Okay. Let's just quickly write it. I want to clean this and write. Good. All right. Let me give you the small note. An increase in temperature favors the endothermic reaction. Please don't forget this. An increase in temperature will favor the endothermic reaction, whereas a decrease in temperature favors what? The exothermic reaction. All right, so now check this. This reaction here is what? Exo. Because delta H is less than zero. I want more products to be formed. So what do I do? This is exo. What favors an exo? A decrease in temperature. So a decrease in temperature will favor my exothermic reaction. The correct answer is D. Please, you need to get back and understand what I've done. Kc value increases. For Kc value to increase, I know that the concentration of the product must increase. Oh, so I want more products. By the way, delta H is less than zero, which is what? The forward reaction is exothermic. A decrease in temperature will favor the exo. An increase in temperature favors the endo. So I want the exo to be favored. What do I need to do? Decrease temperature. My correct option is is D. Beautiful. Let's look at 1.6. I'm loving this. I'm really, really loving this. And I hope you are too. 1.6. All right. So there are certain points that we need to know. Which one of the following statements best describe a dynamic equilibrium? I'm quickly going to define a dynamic equilibrium for you. There are two definitions for dynamic equilibrium. All right. One, it's a state where the rate of the forward reaction, very important that you measure the word rate of the forward reaction, just I'm going to write that for reaction, is equal to the rate of the reverse reaction. And number two, a state where the concentration of the product and concentration of reactants are constant. Please, I'm going to put this in bracket, not equal. They are constant. There's a difference between equality and being constant. Okay, now, option A says the limiting reagent has been used up. The forward and the reverse reactions have stopped. Option B, the rates of the forward and reverse reactions are equal. The rate, let's go check option D. The concentration of the product equals the concentration of the reactants. If you take note, I have already answered this for you. The correct answer is C. Please take note, not equal. If they had said constant, then that would be an option. All right. 1.7. During a titration to determine the concentration of an acid using a standard base, a learner pipettes the base into a conical flask. All right. She then uses a small amount of water, very important, to rinse the inside of the flask so that all the base is part of the solution. How will the extra water added to the flask affect the result in this titration? Okay, let's go again. So a learner takes a pipette and pipettes a base into a conical flask. She then uses a small amount of water to rinse the inside of the flask so that the base, all the base, important, all the base, how will this extra water added to the flask affect the result of the titration? Oh, the concentration of the acid A cannot be determined. B would be lower than expected. C will be higher than expected. D will be the same as expected. All right, it is very important that we focus on the word small. Now, if we focus on the word small, it means that we are not yet tampering. It must be very small, though. We are not yet tampering with the concentration of the base. All right, so the result will be as expected. But if you use too much of water, then you will tamper with the concentration and then change the concentration of the acid. All right, so the concentration of the acid will be the same as what? Expected. By the way, let's check something. This is very tricky. If you have water added to the base, hold on, it actually makes more sense this way. If you had water added to the base, so it's going to be a bit of a diluted base, all right, that will not change the concentration of the acid at all, because we want to determine, this is what we mean, if I have an acid, let's have two here, I have a dilute base and I have a concentrated base. If I use the same acid, let me do this. I want to determine the concentration of the acid, which is the same acid. And I pour that here, and I pour that here. I'm still going to get the same value, irrespective of the concentration of the base, because I can then say Na over Nb equals to CaVa over CbVb. The concentration of the acid has nothing to do with the concentration of the base. So my result will still be as expected, even if I add water. That makes more sense. I hope we get it, right? So even if I have a dilute base and a concentrated base, as long as my acid remains, you know, the way it should be, then I should have the same value of the acid. Beautiful question. I love the tweak of that question, the tone that the examiner used. They really want to confuse us there, but we got them. Okay, let's look at the next one quickly. Now, question 1.8, we move on to electrochemistry. The standard reduction potential for two substances used to set up a galvanic cell are as follows. Now, when we get to electrochemistry, you know, the main key here is to always know what is oxidized and what is reduced. If you get that correct, the whole of electrochemistry becomes very easy. Now, which one of the following combination gives the substances formed at each electrode? Now, let's quickly compare. We have tin, Sn, and copper. The question is, which one will be my cathode and which one would be my anode? There are different ways. I'm just going to show you one quickly so that we then run. If I draw a number line and I have a zero there, a number line moving towards this side will be negative and moving towards this side will be positive. All right, when it comes to electrochemistry, we always reach that we talk about the anode before the cathode. All right, if you write the alphabetical letters, all right, you have A before C. It's always A before C. All right, so it is going to be A and then what? C. Oh, where A talks about the anode and B refers to the cathode. All right, there are so many ways to get this, A and C. Now, let's write the values. Oh, negative 0.14 would be here, which is Sn. And what am I going to have here? Positive 0.34, which is a copper species. It means this is going to be my cathode and that's going to be my anode. We've already sorted out the cathode and anode. Now, which one of the following combination gives the substances formed? We can then write our half cell reaction. Remember, oxidation takes place here, and this is a loss of electron or an increase in oxidation number. So we already said the anode is going to be the first one. So my half reaction would be SN2 plus. It's going to be a loss. Oh, no. If it's going to be a loss, then I'm going to have Sn giving me SN2 plus. Somebody says, how do I know that that is correct? Check this. An increase in oxidation number. Oxidation number here is 0. And oxidation number here is positive 2. There's an increase in oxidation number. That is oxidation. What about reduction? Cu2 plus 2e to give me what? Copper. What is the oxidation number here? Positive 2. This positive 2 here, the charge. And oxidation number here, this is an element in free state. It is what? 0. This is wrong, but I'm just using that to show you. All right. And what do we have here? We have what? A decrease in oxidation number. And this is what? Reduction. So you need to understand first what's at my anode and what's at my cathode and your half cell reactions. Oxidation and increase. So you need to find a way to get that increase and a decrease in oxidation number. Don't forget that already you need to know which one is the cathode. And the cathode, we are going to go through what? Reduction. So Cu2 plus will be reduced to copper, while tin will be oxidized to Sn2 plus. All right, so what are my products? My products are Sn2 plus and copper. What is my correct option? Sn2 plus at the, hold on. This is the anode. And at the cathode, I have copper. Let's go check. At the cathode, I have copper. Where is copper here? Option D. And anode, I have Sn2 plus. Correct. Option D. Beautiful. Beautiful. Let's look at 1.9. I'm loving this whole multiple choice system. And I hope you are learning, guys, from this multiple choice. There's a whole lot of summary that I'm putting together as we go from question to question. Which one of the following half reactions takes place at the positive electrode of an electrochemical cell used to electroplate an iron rod with silver? So we're talking about electrolytic cell here. And we want to electroplate with silver. In lay terms, what does that mean? We want to see silver solid. Okay, we want to see silver solid, all right? And we always see at sea. I mean, we always see at the cathode. That's where solids are formed. Solids are formed at the cathode. We're going to go on later to see something. But we always say that G-strings are nice. Excuse that language. G-strings are nice. Which means in a galvanic cell, the anode is negative. It's just an acronym. The anode is negative. Let me just write this nicely. I'll show you a picture as we go on. In a galvanic cell, the anode is negative. That means in an electrolytic cell, it is the other way around. The anode is now positive. All right. So since we're talking about electrolytic, anode is positive. Let's go back to the question. So when we talk about the anode, I'm just going to write here. Now we're talking about anode. What takes place at the anode? Oxidation. What is oxidation again? Oxidation is the loss of electron, all right, or an increase in oxidation number. Okay, so our focus, guys, is that we are dealing with what? Silver, both at the anode and at the cathode. I'm going to go to my options. In fact, I can write my answer. At the anode, I'll be having loss. So I'm going to have Ag solid giving me Ag plus E. The Ag value here is zero. The Ag value here is positive one. This is the anode. All right. Let me write it here. Ag would give me Ag plus E. At the cathode, I'm going to have reduction because I want to see silver formed. That is going to be silver solid. That's the cathode and that's the anode. So my correct option at the anode, because we are told the positive electrode, my correct option is C. And the last question, which one of the following is a primary nutrient? You know your NPK. Those are your primary nutrients, nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium fertilizers. My correct answer is A. Great. Multiple choice has been done. I hope you did enjoy the multiple choice question. If you did enjoy it like I did, then you are in a good space come Monday when you write your paper. Let's get on to structured questions. Now we go and deal with our organic chemistry. Question 2, question 3, and question 4. Let the games continue.